Does God have a church on earth today that is solidly grounded on the Bible? Is there a people on earth today that God calls His church? And did God have a special people in the Old Testament and in the New Testament days? And then how does the Bible define the church? I will be addressing these questions and concerns directly from God's Word, and welcome once again to the Great Reset, the Future Revealed.
The rise of an international pandemic changes the world in record time. Humanity is struck with fear. We are living in times of anxiety. More than ever before, people are searching for answers. 160 million hits on Google when you key in the word prophecy. Are there answers in the Bible? What does the future have in store? Join international speaker Gideon Pelser on a journey for answers in the Great Reset, Future Revealed. In his work around Africa and the world, he has come face to face with real life struggles, but in the midst of them, he has always found miracles of hope. Join Gideon Pelser for the Great Reset as he shares how Bible prophecies are being fulfilled faster than ever before.
A very hearty and warm welcome to you. I am Gideon Pelser, and thank you for joining me here in this exciting series, The Great Reset, The Future Revealed. Friend, have you wondered, how do you take a stand for Christ? Does God have a visible symbol that you are washed in the blood of Christ? How many kinds of baptism are there? Baptism, what does it mean? Please don't miss this very important study next Wednesday at 7 p.m. Friend, and thank you so much for all the emails and the prayer requests. I pray every morning at 5 a.m. specifically for the requests received, and I would love to pray for you also. Please write to me, gideon@awr.org. Just to name two who I'm praying for presently. Diana, who is requesting God to use her to win her husband over to the truth. And Amy, who is requesting special prayers for her mother-in-law and her whole family. And many, many more. So please email me your prayer requests. Also, if you have any questions, any theological question that you would like me to answer, write to the same email address. Now, my friend, before continuing with the study, I would like to make this list of prophetic symbols available to you. It is an outstanding Bible study aid that you would benefit from greatly while doing Bible study. Then, that is not all. I also have a free ebook for you titled The Desire of Ages. It has as the focal point Jesus Christ, and you will treasure it on your desktop or your tablet or your phone or your laptop. And to receive these free gifts, send me a WhatsApp message to 27 82 44 81 89. I'm going to repeat, +27 82 44 81 89, with the word Bible. Now, on receipt, I will message you so that you may indicate one or all of the following: that you would like special prayer requests, or that if you would like to receive a free Bible study privately on your phone once a week. Thirdly, you will receive reminders of my future studies and YouTube sermons. Fourthly, you will receive invitations to any free prophecy seminars which will be presented in your area from time to time. And fifthly, you might also receive an invitation to a free lunch from time to time. And then lastly, you will receive an invite to join our Facebook group for memorizing Bible portions. So, my friend, don't delay. Send your WhatsApp message with the word Bible to me right now, and my WhatsApp number is +27 82 44 81 89. Please let us pray. Dearest Heavenly Father, thank you so much that my friend and I can get together once again this week. Thank you so much that you've protected us during the last 7 days. Lord, we want to get back into your word today. And we want to understand the vital subject. Is there a special church that is your church today? Lord, we humbly pray this in your Son's name, Jesus Christ. Amen. Today's study is titled, Jesus' Bride is Ready. There are millions of people who are seeking for something they can hold on to, something that gives them peace and hope. And many have tried everything the world has to offer: wealth, fame, power, pleasure, and entertainment. Yet they still found that their hearts were empty and their lives filled with problems. My friend, what does the Bible teach about discovering God's truth for today? Does God have a church on earth today that is solidly grounded on the Word of God? The fact that you are here testifies that you have a certain hunger for genuine Christianity. You have a longing for something more than others have. And your hunger is not merely for a church. Your hunger is for a Bible-believing community. And this is an intense hunger for the living Christ and His truth. It is a longing for a people that base their lives on the Word of God. And those people are those who follow our theme for these studies. If it is in the Bible, I believe it. If it disagrees with the Bible, it is not for me. Friend, material wealth will never satisfy your longing. Things can never satisfy the longing of the soul. Fantasy and pleasure will never satisfy your longing. No form of entertainment can ever satisfy the longing of the soul. Technology cannot satisfy it. And the latest gadgets cannot satisfy the longing of your soul. There exists a longing deep within you to really know God. There is a natural hunger for the Word of God. There is a natural hunger for Bible truth. Now, is there a people on earth today that God calls His church? Upon looking at the history of the Christian church, God has always had a people proclaiming His truth to any given generation. In the days of Noah, God had a special message for all of humanity. Noah appealed to men and women to enter into the ark of safety. And the majority rejected God's call. But God still had a faithful few people who entered the ark. And there was a call for people to step out from the majority. There was a call going out to the popular masses. And there was a call to take a step in faith. And there was a call to get into the ark. And today there is a call to obey God and to get into God's ark of safety in among the people of His church. In the Old Testament, God called Abraham out of the popular majority. In Genesis 26, verse 2, we read, "Then the Lord appeared to him and said, 'Do not go down to Egypt. Live in the land of which I shall tell you about.'" God called Abraham out of the popular culture to follow him completely. Verse 5 reads, "Because Abraham obeyed my voice and kept my charge, my commandments and my statutes and my laws." My friend, God chose Moses to lead his people to be faithful to him and keep his commandments. And in the days of ancient Israel, God called out a faithful, obedient group. Deuteronomy 11 verse 1 reads, "Therefore, you shall love the Lord your God and keep His charge, His statutes, His judgments, and His commands always." In the days of Noah, a people who loved God kept His commandments and got into the ark. In the days of Abraham, a people who loved God stepped out from the majority and kept His commandments. And in the days of ancient Israel, a people who loved God and kept His commandments were called Israel. God called them His chosen, His special people. And in the days of the New Testament, Peter preached powerfully. 3,000 were baptized on the day of Pentecost. And as they were baptized, they stepped out and became God's special people to keep His commandments. 1 Peter 2 verse 9 reads, "But you are a chosen generation, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, His own special people." Did God have a special people in the days of Noah, my friend? Certainly He did. Did God have a special people in the days of Abraham? Absolutely. And in the days of Moses, did God have a special people? Yes, He did. Now, was there a special people in Peter's days? Were these God's special people? Yes, indeed. God's special people were always characterized by obedience. They loved God and obeyed God. They were separated out from the majority. They were a commandment-keeping people. Verse 9 continues, "That you may proclaim the praises of Him who called you out of darkness into His marvelous light." So, my friend, God called them from darkness to light, from error to truth, from commandment breaking to commandment keeping. When you take a step to follow truth and become part of God's commandment keeping people, you will not deny any truth that you did not believe in the past. And by attending and following a series of studies like this, where new truth is found, you might find yourself in a difficult spot. And with the discovery of new truths from God's Word, it would produce internal conflict because of changes that you might need to take. A battle develops in the mind with the question, will I have to deny everything I believed in the past to follow this new truth? My friend, certainly not. Look back at that past and say, I thank God for that past. Every church or denomination has a lot of truth and some light which is directly from God. While we may appreciate our past, we commit ourselves to following complete truth that God reveals to us today. Should you have been raised a Methodist, a Baptist, or a Pentecostal, why not say, thank you, God, for my journey thus far, and I will accept your further light because you've blessed me with further light and further truth. And by taking this step to follow Jesus, in becoming a part of His special commandment-keeping people, you are not necessarily denying any of your past heritage. You will simply cast off one or two errors that were handed down from the past and eliminating falsehoods that slipped into the church a long time ago. It simply means dropping off some baggage that you inherited that is not in harmony with God's Word as you understand it today. You will then, from now on, walk ahead in the fullness of truth. And upon finding the truth, you will want to find a church that teaches this truth. And upon discovering truth from God's Word, it is now important to find a church, my friend, that squares up with the Bible 100%. And you may wonder, how does the Bible define the church? 1 Timothy 3:15 reads, "I write so that you may know how you ought to conduct yourself in the house of God, which is the church of the living God, the pillar and ground of the truth." My friend, the church of the living God is the pillar, the ground of truth. The church is the custodian of truth. John 17 verse 17 reads, "Sanctify them by your truth. Your word is truth." John 8 verse 32 reads, "And you shall know the truth, and the truth shall make you free." Now some say, but we cannot know truth. It's not possible to know truth. But what does Jesus say? Jesus says, you shall know the truth. And then Jesus adds, my friend, if you come to God with an open mind, with a seeking spirit, with an honest heart, He will reveal His truth to you. But if you come locked in your own opinions, you will be unable to understand His truth. There is no point approaching God's Word, desiring to prove your own point or stance or position. In so doing, you will not discover His will. Your own thoughts will influence what you read in His Word. And when you ask, "Lord, show me truth," even if it's different from what I already believe, He will reveal His will. God will show you the truths of His Word. The book of Revelation describes God's faithful people who would cling to truth at any cost. And the 12th chapter of Revelation describes the history of the Christian church more clearly than anywhere else in the Bible. It describes God's plan and His people down through the ages. It also describes Satan's vicious attacks in four distinct episodes. It reveals to you the identifying characteristics of the special group of people today called God's church without a shadow of a doubt. Revelation 12 begins by describing a woman who appears in heaven, the bride of Jesus Christ. Now notice what a woman represents in Bible prophecies. 2 Corinthians 11 verse 2 reads, "For I am jealous for you with godly jealousy, for I've betrothed you to one husband, that I may present you a chaste virgin to Christ." The Apostle Paul presents the church as Jesus' bride. Revelation 12 continues the description of the battle between good and evil. And verse 9 reads, "So the great dragon was cast out, that serpent of old, called the devil and Satan, who deceives the whole world. He was cast to the earth, and his angels were cast out with him." Now let's look at these four episodes. Episode number 1 is described in Revelation chapter 12. Satan rebels against God in heaven. But Christ wins and Satan loses, and Satan is cast out of heaven. So in episode 1, God is victorious. Episode 2, centuries pass by. Revelation 12 verses 4 and 5 reads, "And the dragon stood before the woman, who was ready to give birth, to devour her child as soon as it was born." Satan's focus and efforts were on destroying baby Jesus. The devil is angry. He stands before the woman. She bore a male child who was to rule all nations with a rod of iron. And this male child that would rule all nations with a rod of iron is Jesus Christ. Did Satan try to destroy Jesus when he was born? Did he? Yes, Herod passed a decree that all male children be killed. And a child was caught up to God and his throne. Now what happened? The Holy Family fled to Egypt, and God preserved them there. Satan couldn't destroy Christ. And in the wilderness, many years later, Satan appeared as an angel of light, tempting Jesus with the hope of destroying him once and again. And again, Jesus wins and Satan loses. On the cross, Satan tried to destroy Christ, but our Lord triumphed. And Jesus said, "Into thy hands I commit my spirit." And he committed himself to his Father. And he went into the grave and was raised from the dead. And what does Revelation 12 verse 5 say? "And her child was caught up to God and his throne." His mission of salvation was accomplished, and Jesus ascended to heaven. So even in episode 2, Satan tries to destroy Jesus, and what happens? Christ wins and Satan loses. God provided a way of safety. Now let us look at episode number 3. Satan turns his wrath onto the followers of Christ. All but one of the disciples died a martyr's death. And Satan attacks the church. the state and church united in the days of Constantine and in the days following. And for a while, the church enjoyed the state's favor and unusual popularity. Then persecution followed. And as church and state united, Satan attacked by fiercely persecuting the true believers. And Revelation 12 verse 6 says, "Then the woman fled into the wilderness, where she has a place prepared by God." My friend, when Satan attempted to destroy the church in the dark ages, the woman, that is the church, fled into the wilderness, that they should feed her there 1,260 days. 1,260 days. Now remember, my friend, in Bible prophecy, one prophetic day equals one literal year. I remind you of Ezekiel 4 verse 6. "I've laid on you a day for each year." And Numbers 14, 34. "For each day you shall bear your guilt 1 year, namely 40 years. So the church was in the wilderness for 1,260 years. And the popular church and state have united. And as we've studied in previous studies, during the Dark Ages, which began in AD 538 and ended in 1798, that was a period of the 1,260 years. And during this time period, God's true church was in the wilderness. Faithful men and women of God clung to the truths of God's word in seclusion, and the reformers were persecuted for their faith. Even during this time, God had faithful men and women whose minds were bound by the principles of God's word. Now, in Revelation 12, we see episode 3 very clearly, where Satan tries to destroy Christ's church during that period of 1,260 years. Still, Christ wins and Satan loses. And the wilderness period ended in 1798 with the capture of the Pope by Napoleon's general Berthier. And this is where the prophecy becomes very fascinating. Sometime after 1798, God would raise up his end time people. Just like in the days of Noah, Abraham and Moses, God would have a special commandment keeping people. Like in the days of the New Testament and of the Dark Ages, God would have a special commandment-keeping people that would be faithful to Him. The book of Revelation describes the identifying characteristics of God's last day people with these specific important words found in Revelation 12 verse 17. "And the dragon was enraged with the woman, and he went to make war with the rest of her offspring, who keep the commandments of God and have the testimony of Jesus Christ." My friend, Abraham kept God's commandments. Moses kept God's commandments. The Israelites kept God's commandments. And the New Testament church kept God's commandments. And the book of Revelation describes the bride of Christ as a Bible-believing, Christ-centered, grace-filled movement that keeps the commandments of God. And here are the characteristics that the 12th chapter of the book of Revelation gives you and I to identify God's people today. It says that they keep the commandments of God and they have the testimony of Jesus. Now notice, my friend, firstly, they keep the commandments of God, and God will raise up a people who love Him so much that they obey Him. And in the heart of God's Ten Commandment law, we discover the very basis of worship. And we worship God because we are His creatures. He is our Creator. And the Sabbath command leads us to worship Him supremely as the Creator of heaven and earth. "Remember the Sabbath day to keep it holy. 6 days shalt thou labor and do all thy work, but the seventh day is the Sabbath of the Lord thy God." And here is a commandment-keeping people, described in the book of Revelation, that keep the seventh day Sabbath. Ye are a people of the new covenant. And God says of them in Hebrews 10 verse 16, I will put my laws into their hearts and into their minds. There I will write them. And they sense that God's 10 laws, His 10 commandments, is the real happy way to live life. And these laws define and protect life at its best. God's people are not some super saints. They are weak. They also falter. They also make mistakes. And God has placed His law in their minds so that they know it, and in their hearts so that they love it. And the book of Revelation describes this last day people as having two characteristics. They keep the commandments of God, and they have the testimony of Jesus. Now, my friend, what is this testimony of Jesus? What is this all about? And the Bible defines the testimony of Jesus. They that have the testimony of Jesus Christ, that's Revelation 12 verse 17, and the testimony of Jesus is the spirit of prophecy, Revelation 19 verse 10. So the testimony of Jesus is the spirit of prophecy, Revelation 19 verse 10. Revelation 12 says that the bride of Christ is a Bible-believing church that loves Jesus, that keeps His commandments, and has the testimony of Jesus, or they have the spirit of prophecy. Friend, God's last day people will be guided by the gift of prophecy. And the Bible talks about the prophetic gift in God's last day church in 1 Corinthians 1 verse 7. So that you come short in no gift, eagerly waiting for the revelation of our Lord Jesus Christ. The church waiting for the coming of Jesus will have all the gifts necessary for the last days. And one of the important gifts of the Spirit is the gift of prophecy. If the gift of prophecy was needed in the first century church to guide it and to protect it from error, it will certainly be needed by the last day church as well. All the gifts of the Spirit will be manifest in God's church, and God's church will be Spirit-filled. It will be a powerful church, and we will see miraculous healings from time to time in God's church if God so chooses. He will bless it with unusual prophetic insight, and there will be dramatic breakthroughs. The Holy Spirit will be poured out, and thousands will become part of His spiritual community. God's church is a spiritual church that impacts the whole world, not just locally. Jesus commissioned His disciples, go into all the world, not just locally. The true church will be a worldwide body committed to Christ and obedient to His word. And Jesus said in Matthew 28 verses 19 and 20, go therefore and make disciples of all nations. My friend, all nations were to come to a Bible-believing, grace-filled, commandment-keeping, Sabbath-keeping, Spirit-empowered movement. And then the text continues, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe all things that I've commanded you, and lo, I'm with you always, even to the end of the age. Amen. My friend, in every era, going back thousands of years, God would have a people who respond to His grace and love. People who commit their lives to Him and obediently follow Him into the watery grave of baptism. And they become part of His church, a special people who are committed to follow His truth. Revelation 14 describes this last day movement, my friend. And just feel the power and the significance of this, and let your heart beat with excitement as Revelation describes this last day movement. Revelation 14 verse 6 and 7. Then I saw another angel flying in the midst of heaven, having the everlasting gospel to preach to those who dwell on the earth, to every nation, tribe, tongue, and people. Now, my friend, is this a small non-denominational movement? Not at all. The Bible talks of a worldwide, global movement that is preaching the gospel to every nation, tribe, tongue, and people, saying with a loud voice, "Fear God and give glory to Him, for the hour of His judgment has come." My friend, what does it mean to fear God? Does it mean to be afraid? No, not at all. It means reverence. It means to respect God. How do you glorify God? To glorify God means to honor Him in how you live, both with your diet and your lifestyle. Whatever you eat or drink, do all to the glory of God. 1 Corinthians 10:31. Now, what does 1 Corinthians 6, verses 19 and 20 say? "Know you not that you are bought with a price? Therefore, glorify God in your body." Why should you do this? For the hour of His judgment has come. And the message flying amid heaven represents a church, a movement which calls men and women to the fact that we are accountable to God for our actions. In an age of irresponsibility, God is calling for moral responsibility. God is calling for obedience. And God's final message for mankind declares the hour of His judgment has come. And this is a special message in a special time in earth's history. No more business as usual. No more pleasures as usual. And the hour of God's judgment is come. And the message continues in verse 7. "And worship Him who made heaven and earth, the sea and springs of water." Now, my friend, who should you worship? God, your Creator. And God's final call, my friend, is a call to worship your Creator. And the Sabbath is part of God's last day message. The Sabbath is a call to come apart from the world every Sabbath, every seventh day, to worship God. And all of this is part of the end time message. And all of this is part of an urgent message. And all of this is part of a last day message for God's last day movement. Now, you need to understand this message very clearly today. And God invites you to become part of His last day movement. And God invites you to be part of a special people, a worldwide communion that is keeping God's commandments. This is a Bible-based people. This is a Sabbath-keeping, a second coming Advent movement. Don't be embroiled in teachings that are incompatible with the Scripture of Jesus Christ. God's true church must and will meet the identifying characteristics of the true church found in Revelation 12. Number one, they will recapture the pure faith of the disciples. Now, my heart longs to recapture the faith of the disciples. This is not denominationalism. It is much more than that. It is recapturing and reaffirming the Bible truths that have been lost sight of. Number two, God's church will have two characteristics according to Revelation 12. They will keep the commandments of God, and they will be guided by the gift of prophecy. Now, my friend, the Seventh-day Adventist church qualifies on both of these counts. Number three, it'll be a worldwide mission-driven movement. It'll be a movement that goes to every nation, every kindred, every tongue, and every people. It'll be a movement that accepts men and women of all races, of all language groups, and of all creeds. It'll be a movement that believes that God is the God of all people. And it'll be a worldwide movement. Now, the Seventh-day Adventist Church is the largest international Protestant mission movement in the whole world. Worshipping God in over 200 of the 215 countries listed by the United Nations. And then number four, they will call people to total commitment to Christ. It'll be a movement that says, fear God. It calls men and women to total commitment to Jesus Christ. And the Seventh-day Adventist Church points you to Christ. And then fifthly, they will lead people to the Bible Sabbath. It will be a movement that leads people to accept God's last day Bible Sabbath and worship your Creator. The Seventh-day Adventist Church keeps the Bible Seventh-day Sabbath. Then number six, they will be encouraging people to give their bodies to God, to give up alcohol, tobacco, and any unclean foods. It will be a movement that says, fear God and give glory to Him. And the Seventh-day Adventist Church has a strong, health, Bible-based message. And then number seven, they will make a final appeal for others to accept Bible truth. My friend, I am a Seventh-day Adventist because I've been honestly studying the Bible and I've looked at the facts of Scripture very carefully. And I want to be part of a church that is Bible-based. And this is exactly what the Seventh-day Adventist Church is all about. I want to be part of a church that teaches that salvation is not by works, but by grace. And the Seventh-day Adventist Church upholds Jesus Christ. I want to be part of a movement that follows in the footsteps of Bible heroes like Abraham and Isaac and Jacob, like Isaiah and Jeremiah, like Matthew, Mark and John, keeping God's commandments and doing His will. The Seventh-day Adventist Church keeps all God's commandments. And I want to be part of a movement that understands that our bodies are the temple of God. A movement that calls us to glorify God in your bodies, your hearts, and in your minds. Because we are physical, mental, and spiritual beings. And what we put into our bodies affects our spiritual life. I want to be part of a movement that calls men and women just like Christ did when He said, if you love me, keep my commandments. My friend, the Ten Commandments says to remember the Sabbath day to keep it holy. And I want to be part of a movement that looks at the book of Revelation in honesty. A movement that does not dodge certain Bible texts. Now, the Seventh-day Adventist movement is firmly planted and established powerfully throughout the entire world. In 2004, a very exciting satellite evangelistic series was held in Rwanda. An unprecedented number of 10,000 people were baptized. However, in May 2016, more than 100,000 people were baptized as a result of 2,227 evangelistic meetings held throughout the country simultaneously. This has been one of the largest evangelistic events and baptisms in history of the Seventh-day Adventist Church and one of the largest in the history of the Christian Church. And subsequently, we have in Zambia held 1,080 evangelistic campaigns simultaneously. In fact, my daughter was involved in that. And we baptized 18,600 people. And then again, in Papua New Guinea, in the last 12 months, we've baptized over 120,000 people. And then in 2017, we had a massive campaign in the middle of Europe, comprising 4,200 evangelistic campaigns simultaneously per day. 4,200 campaigns per day. And thousands of baptisms. My friend, what makes the difference? God's people were mobilized to prepare and preach thousands of evangelistic meetings all at the same time across the whole world. And God's people were inspired by a new church, this new initiative called the Total Member Involvement. And this involves and pulls all members into the spreading of the gospel message. Thousands of lives were changed, and God's Spirit was felt in a powerful way across Rwanda, Central Europe, Zambia, Papua New Guinea, etc., etc. And the gospel message had brought hope and joy in Jesus to its people. The interest in Bible truth has been so great that currently 1,000 one-day churches are being built across the world to accommodate new members. This means that there are Adventist teams who get together and erect a new church only in one day, one per day. Isn't that amazing? Isn't God amazing? God works, even though His people may not be the most popular or the best known. God's church is not in the majority. You can never base truth on a majority vote. And we regularly witness this with presidential electoral voting. Did the majority go into the ark, or were they outside the ark? My friend, the majority was outside the ark. In the days of Jesus, did the majority say, "Take that man off the cross"? Or did the majority say, "Crucify him"? Most of the time, the majority has not been accurate when it comes to understanding Bible truth. God's church does not need the approval of popular religious leaders. Truth is truth, whether religious leaders accept it as truth or not. The Spirit of God works on the hearts of people, bringing them to realize the truth during any series of studies like this Great Reset Future Revealed series. It is likely that you might seek advice, which might lead you to your present religious leader, to ask him about the new truths that you have learnt. And the real issue, my friend, is not what your religious leader or your priest or your pastor or your reverend or your dominie thinks. The only issue is what is written in God's Word. And now my good friend Anina Wasserman will share this magnificent song, "The Holy City," with you and I.
The song grew true as the shadow of a cross that rose upon a lonely hill, as the shadow of a cross that rose upon a lonely hill. Jerusalem, Jerusalem, hark all the angels sing, Hosanna in the highest, Hosanna to your King. And once again the scene was changed, new earth it seemed to be. I saw the holy city beside the tideless sea. The light of God was on the streets, the gates were open wide, and old night winter, and no one was denied. No need of moon or stars by night, or sun to shine.
I want you, my friend, to see the holy city soon. Beside the tideless sea, the light of God will be on the streets, and the gates will be opened wide for you to enter and not be denied. The fact that you are listening at this moment testifies that you are a truth seeker. And deep within your heart, you long for truth. You are searching for a worldwide movement that follows all God's word. As you've been listening to these studies, perhaps you're having an inward struggle between this new truth and what you've previously believed. Friend, that is normal and is expected. You feel convicted about these truths you have found, and you sense the presence of the Holy Spirit urging you. Would you like to say, Jesus, right now, I'm going to give up the battle. I'm going to open my heart and I want to walk in your truth. I'm going to take that step to follow you, Lord. My friend, often it's not easy to take that step. But when God calls you, you must follow. Be wise and follow the convictions of the Holy Spirit that is prodding your heart. Friend, truth beckons you to follow it. And decide now, right now, to follow the truth of God's word all the way. That'll be the wisest decision you will ever make. Make that choice right now. There's a joy, an unparalleled joy, which comes from following God's truth. And God invites you to make that decision right now, my friend. I've never met a person who has ever said, "I wish I would have waited more, longer before making my decision for Christ." But I've met many people who have said, "I wish I've responded earlier, many years ago." My friend, this is your hour. This is your moment of truth. And as I pray now, say, "Yes, Jesus, I will follow your truth wherever you lead me." Please let us bow our heads in prayer. Dearest Lord God, I pray very especially for my friend this afternoon. May he or she find this change that they need to make not too difficult. Lord, assist them in getting rid of the obstacles from family, from friends, from pastors, priests, etc. May they remain Bible-based. May my friend be Bible-based in her or in his decision. They know this truth now. She knows this truth now. He knows this truth now. Lord, assist so that truth will be decided on. And then maybe my friend would like to be baptized. Lord, may they contact me with this request for baptism so that I may assist them to lead them through the watery grave where they will leave off the old life and start a new life in Christ, where the old is washed away by the blood and the grace of Jesus Christ. Lord, be with my friend till we meet again in 7 days' time, next Wednesday at 7 p.m. This is our humble prayer that we pray humbly in the name of Jesus, our Savior. Amen. Friend, please persevere. Cling to God's word now. Accept only God's word. Don't accept anything that anybody else says to you, please. God is calling you now. Decide for truth, please. It is great to learn from God's word. Friend, if it's in the Bible, you can believe it and you can accept it. If it disagrees with the Bible, it is not for you. Remember to send me that WhatsApp message with the word Bible to receive those free items. +27 82 444 8189. Send that now, please. Until next Wednesday, bye-bye.